Today we're going to talk about the new Holley dual sync distributors. Holley currently offers dual sync distributors that are plug and play with Holley EFI that are available for several popular engine applications from Chevrolet, Chrysler, Ford, Oldsmobile, as well as Pontiac. When you go to install a Holley dual sync distributor, the first thing that you're going to need to do is go in and properly configure the EFI software for the new ignition type. We're going to do that now. The first thing you're going to want to do is make sure that the software global folder matches the global folder on the ECU. We'll do this by going up with the ignition on, with the engine off, click the USB link, it'll go online. Click online again and put it back to USB link. You'll go to your ignition parameters, and for this type of ignition, you'll need to set the ignition type as custom. You will then want to click the configure button. The crank sensor type is going to be set at one pulse per fire. The sensor type, you will want to select digital falling. The inductive delay would be a good starting point of around 100. In this case, we'd want to set the ignition reference angle at 50 degrees before top dead center. This distributor is dual sync, so it has a cam as well as a crank sensor input. We'll need to set up the cam sensor input as well. Just like the crank, it'll be set for single pulse as well as digital falling. Now you need to set up the output type. For this installation, we're going to assume that you're going to use a MSD style ignition box, in which case we would set it points output out of the ignition options. And you'd want to set the dwell time between 1.8 and 2 milliseconds. At this time, we'd want to sync to the ECU again. And you'll notice that it's failed on the system settings. The reason that it failed is because we have made some changes, and we do want to sync those changes to the ECU. So we go down and we'd select send to ECU. Once everything passes, this will time out approximately 5 seconds, and we'll want to cycle the ignition off and back on. It's very important to make sure that you set the ignition parameters correctly before proceeding with further installation of the distributor. Once you get the ignition parameters set correctly, it'll eliminate any chances of having erroneous readings when you go to sync the pickups in the next couple steps. From this point, we need to make sure that we have the engine set at top dead center on number one cylinder on the compression stroke before we remove the existing distributor, and we'll show you how to do that now. We're now going to proceed with setting the crankshaft at the proper location for distributor installation. Today we're going to use a mock-up engine. It gives us a little bit better visibility as to how we're going to go ahead and set that up. It's important to make sure that when you're turning the crankshaft that you're turning it in a direction of engine rotation. We want to make sure that we set it up on number one's compression stroke. In this case, we want to set it up at 50 degrees before top dead center. If your harmonic damper is not marked out to 50 degrees, you don't have to get too concerned about that. The instruction sheets included give you a general reference diagram based on a 6-inch, 7-inch, or 8-inch harmonic balancer, and basically tell you how far you have to measure from the zero mark around to 50 degrees before top dead center. Depending on the direction of rotation of the crankshaft, it's going to depend on which way you need to go from zero to put the mark. In this case, small block Chevrolet rotates clockwise, so you would want to continue clockwise to that measurement for the 50 degree mark. If your balancer diameter is not one listed in the chart, you can simply take the diameter of the balancer, multiply that times 3.14, divide it by 360, take that total, multiply it by 50, and that will give you the dimension that you need to measure from zero to your 50 degree before top dead center mark. It's real important, as we mentioned earlier, to make sure you're on compression. Otherwise, you can be 180 degrees out. An easy way to do that is to remove number one spark plug, put a ratchet or breaker bar on the crankshaft. As you're coming around and you're approaching your 50 degree mark before top dead center on number one, simply stick your finger over the spark plug hole and you should be making pressure. If you're not picking up pressure, you're probably 180 degrees out. You want to turn the crankshaft slowly until you align your 50 degree mark at zero on your timing pointer. Once we have our crankshaft set at 50 degrees before top dead center on number one, We want to verify that we're still in the right phasing and we're not 180 degrees out. We checked it with pressure, but it's always a good idea to double check. One of the easiest ways to do that is remove your distributor cap and make sure that your rotor is still pointing at your existing number one cylinder. If the rotor is pointing the opposite direction, that would be an indication that you're 180 degrees out. Not a real big problem. You just need to go back to the front. You need to turn the engine around one full revolution before you proceed. Once you've confirmed this, for safety, you want to disconnect the battery. You also want to unplug your fuel injectors and disconnect the power and ground connections at your ignition coils. You don't want to have any erroneous sparks or any fuel that may be entering into the system when you don't want it to. From that point, we can go ahead and we can remove our existing distributor. One precaution that I like to have people do is before you remove the distributor from the engine, you want to kind of look around and make sure you don't have any loose debris that could possibly fall in. We don't really have to worry about this with this mock-up engine, but in a vehicle, a lot of times you may have some leaves or other debris in the back. Once you remove the hold down, you simply remove your distributor and we'll lay that off to the side. We need to get our new dual sync distributor ready for installation. The first thing you're going to do is remove the distributor cap, loosen up the hold downs, turn them out of the way, and just set the cap off to the side. When you go to install this distributor, there's a couple things you want to look at first. If the block has ever been decked or the heads have been machined and decked, you want to make sure that you don't possibly bottom the distributor out and bind up the pump drive. A simple way to do this is just to dry install the distributor without the gasket and make sure that the distributor fully seats with its mating surface. In this case, we don't have any gaps. If you were to find a gap where it may be raised, you'd need to rectify that before installation. A lot of times, depending on how much interference you have, you may simply be able to rectify it by installing two distributor gaskets. In this case, we sit down flush, so we can go ahead and pull that out and get it ready for installation. If the engine's recently been run and you intend to start it again very soon, you can simply lubricate the distributor gear with an ample amount of engine oil. If the engine's not going to be started right away, it would be highly recommended to coat it generously with a Molly lubricant or cam break-in lubricant before installation. We'll go ahead and put our gasket on. Now, when you go to install the distributor, one thing that also be conscientious of is your cam type. The Holley distributor includes a steel gear. If you have a billet camshaft, you're going to need a bronze gear for that application. When you go to install the distributor, you want to line up the rotor orientation in a vicinity of the tower that you want to be used for number one. One thing to keep in mind when you go to drop it in, as it mates with the cam gear, it will rotate. So depending on where you want it installed, you may find that you just have to pull it up, bump it back a couple teeth to get it to set in place where you want it. Once it's installed, you want to turn the housing until the rotor contact is aligned with this black crank sensor. That's going to kind of be your home starting point for installation. Once you have the distributor seated, I would recommend taking your hold down, installing it loosely, finger tight is fine at this time. That has helped stabilize the distributor. It would be a good time to reconnect the connections at the battery, where you do not want to reconnect the ignition coil or the injectors at this time. The battery reconnected, you will find a mating connector on the main engine harness that's got a tag on it for ignition. You want to plug that in securely and turn your ignition on. You do not want to crank the engine. In this case, you just turn the key to the run position. If you've aligned everything properly, you've got your battery reconnected, you should see two red LEDs light in a distributor. The LED that is closest to the crank sensor is going to indicate crank positions. The sensor furthest away is going to indicate cam. So if the cam LED is lit, the cam's active. If the crank LED is lit, the crank is active. When the LED is lit, that would indicate a digital falling state. When they go off, it would be digital rising. From this point, we need to phase our pickups. If your rotor turns clockwise on the engine, you will set it up a little bit different than if the rotor turns counterclockwise. Since we're dealing with a small block Chevrolet, our rotor is going to turn in a clockwise direction. In order to set it up, you would grab the housing and you would turn it clockwise to the center of the vane, and you'll see that the crank LED has gone off. That indicates that the ECU is recognizing it as digital rising. You would then slowly turn the housing counterclockwise until the LED turns back on. At that point, you would lock the distributor down. If your distributor turned counterclockwise, you would do it in a similar fashion. However, when you set it with the alignment of the rotor contact to the crank sensor, you would then turn the housing counterclockwise until the crank LED shut off, and then you would turn it back slowly until where it just come on, and you would then lock it down. We're now going to proceed with installing our distributor cap. We've already determined that this is going to be the location of our number one spark plug wire. We're going to go ahead and install the cap. You want to make sure that the hold down tabs are in the groove in the bottom of the housing. We're going to go ahead and snug down the cap. Now, the Holley dual sync distributor can be used for applications other than a conventional distributor. It can be used for a cam and a crank sync for applications that use Holley DIS ignition. In that case, instead of installing a distributor cap, we would install this cover. In order to install that cover, simply remove the cap, take a Phillips head screwdriver, and remove the existing rotor, and we'll replace it with our pickup cover. When you install it, there is a locating notch that will align with this location here in the housing, and you want to make sure that is properly aligned, and then you simply snug down the hold down clamps. Because we intend to use this as a regular distributor, we went ahead, took the cap off that we would utilize for DIS cam and crank sync, reinstalled our rotor and our distributor cap. Now's a good time to reinstall your ignition wires, and I would suggest putting a new set of plugs and wires in it at this time. Once you get those installed, you want to double check the timing. You don't want to hook the fuel injectors back up yet. You want to do a base timing check and make some adjustments as required before you physically try to start the engine. Before continuing with timing checks, it's important to make sure that you have your distributor hold down fully tightened to eliminate any chance of that distributor moving. From that point, you'll want to go to your software, go to your ignition parameters, and check your cranking parameters and look at your cranking timing. In this case, we're currently set at 15 degrees cranking. Before we try to start the engine, we're going to want to confirm that we are at the 15 degree mark. In order to do that, you simply take a timing light, crank the engine over, and confirm you're at 15 degrees. If you find that the timing's off a little bit, don't be overly concerned. You can loosen up your hold down just enough to allow you to make small adjustments to the distributor and make very small, slow adjustments until the timing matches at 15 degrees. Once that matches, go back in with your wrench and securely fasten and lock down that distributor. From that point, we can proceed to try to start the engine. We'd go in, connect our fuel injectors, cycle the key off and back on to prime the fuel system, go ahead and try to fire the engine up at this point. If you followed all of these steps, the engine should fire up and run. At that point, I would suggest going into your software settings, go into your sync drop-down menu where you would have originally done a TPS auto set, and you can go in and click on enable static timing check. Once you click on enable static timing check, you can set a fixed value. I will normally set a fixed value of about 10 degrees. Depending on your engine, it may be a little bit different. Put in 10 degrees and hit set. And what that's going to do is that's going to override any other timing modifiers that can affect the timing as well as your timing curve. From that point, you would want to carefully, and I emphasize carefully, rev the engine up to about 3,000 to 4,000 RPM and check with the time light and make sure that the timing is still at that 10 degree mark. If the timing is not, you can go back to the inductive delay that we discussed earlier and make some adjustments. In order to do this, you would need to go offline and select ignition parameters, click configure, and make changes to your inductive delay as required. I recommend making changes in units of 20. If you find that your timing retards at a higher RPM, you will want to increase the inductive delay. If you find that your timing advances, you will want to decrease the delay. Once you sync these changes to the ECU, you'll need to cycle the ignition. Depending on your software version, you may see a pop-up window that serves as a reminder. Once you've confirmed that your timing is accurate at idle as well as higher RPM, you're really done with your installation at this point. For more information on this product and other great Holley EFI products, go to www.holley.com or contact your local Holley EFI dealer today.